a huge privilege, and a little bit intimidating at first, because obviously the legacy of Mel Gibson and being Mad Max is so total and so finite, and that's that. So there's no point in trying to wrestle that in any way, shape, or form, or try to pretend that he isn't Mad Max. So ultimately, the stepping into the shoes scenario wasn't necessarily a stepping into the shoes scenario, but really looking at George and saying, George, what do you need me to do? Because this is your world, and you've created the first Mad Max, and the second, and the third, and now you've had 10 years to meditate on it, and you've come back with a huge and epic adventure, of which we need to transmute for you. So what do you need from me in order to play the role? Of which is a very small part of a very, very big landscape and machine. Well, it was all in for a penny, in for a pound, really. Once you got to Namibia, there was no distinguished line between where I start and end and where Jacob starts and where he ends, you know, because we had to work together very closely in transmuting the Max that Jules wanted, which was a mixture of parable and language, you know, obviously the dialogue and the face pulling or the acting stuff that was going on. But then the physical life was both adopted by Jacob and I, which then had a transference into much more arduous stunt work, where then it would also put me into certain safer situations, as it were, and then Jacob into the much more riskier situations, along with the landscape of the driving world and the stunt world as well that was going alongside it, if that makes sense. So there was a kind of blend between us, and we all came to it together, but from different departments.
Well,
you did all of them.
I would rehearse the majority of them. We would rehearse a particular stunt over and over, and have a few different variations to pitch to George to see which one he liked the best. And then we would run that through, and would work the wires, and would work closely with the rigging team, and would minimize any hazards we could, and then would invite Tom in to do the stunt, and he would usually knock it out of the park, like with one or two takes, where it took me majority of the morning to get it done. So.
That's kind of you.
No, it's true.
He did anything that was really dangerous, and then they threw me on anything that I felt like I would survive. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And anything that, you know, anything that would keep me there in the morning so I could do some more filming.
Yeah.
But I think the nature of nowadays in film work is that they want to get, you know, their actor or their talent in as close to the action as possible, so you can't see the difference between what's a stunt, what's, you know, technically CGI. Although in this film, what's amazing about it is that, and a testament to, you know, all the departments that worked on it, and to George as well, is that it's live action. So that's why, you know, Jacob's here and ultimately played Max as much as I played Max. You know, it was a team sport, which is quite kind of a different step out and say, look, you know, stuntmen weren't behind the scenes on this one. They were totally, and women, because Dana as well, hugely supported the Furiosa character in developing and bringing that to the screen. And although the actors did participate to an extent, you know, more than they would normally, because that is, you know, how we like action movies these days, to get our talent right up close and personal. There was just stuff that you cannot do because you will not be there in the morning. You know, and luckily Jacob's still with us.
And there's no point really in the film where there isn't anything that isn't considered a stunt. Like from start to finish, it's one epic chase, right? So theoretically, it's a stunt throughout the whole thing. So I need to be there. I need to be Max predominantly through the film as well.